Thanks, Darby. I appreciate the opportunity to come and talk to you a little bit about EPDs. And so just a little bit about what we're gonna talk about today is kind of some of the things that we've been associated with EPDs, how you might use them, and we're gonna go into a little bit more detail, which I'll allude to here in a little bit. But I really appreciate the opportunity to come and speak to you about EPDs because they've been proven to be a very reliable selection tool, but there are some cautions associated with using these because you can change animals in the next generation pretty rapidly. So hopefully this will go through, and if you have questions as we go through about a particular slide, please feel free to interrupt me and ask questions, okay? Or we can take those at the end if you're more comfortable doing that. I'm pretty flexible, and I'm used to teaching undergraduate students where after 50 minutes there are absolutely no questions. And then I teach some grad students, and they're a little bit more interactive. But I find that producers and breeders are really the ones that, because they understand what this might help them do, are really the most interested. So I really enjoy giving talks to breeders. So, you know, with a lot's happened over the last few years relative to EPD and genetic improvement, but we've gone from AOA to and originally ARI to a situation where we can identify the top 1% of genetics for a variety of traits. So really what I want to do is how did we get from just pictures and visually appraising animals to another tool in our toolbox to make genetic improvement? How did we get to the ability to rank animals on their genetic merit based on where they perform or what their breeding values are for a variety of traits? So really that's what I want to talk about today. And what I'm going to cover, okay, these are kind of the four main points. And some of you have seen me give a talk before, so we'll cover some of the same material, especially on interpretation and maybe what EPD represent and what they don't represent. And so we want to start out with a general perspective on the biology. And when we make improvement, what determines how fast we make genetic improvement? And combine that with the biology so we can focus in on an animal's genetics and what it passes to the next generation. Then go to application. What are EPD? How are they calculated? What advantages are there to EPD? And what that's going to do, and I'm not sure if you'll be able to see the pointer or not, what that's going to do, that third bullet, is actually tie us into the first bullet. What do EPD do well? Then I want to talk a little bit about data collection. As you think about how you gather fleece samples or how you take weights, things to remember as you submit that data, because from my standpoint, I want to make the most use of that data that I can. I want to make it the most valuable. And so there's some restrictions on how data is used, or maybe some filters, if you will, and this hopefully will help you understand how best to report data so that we get the maximum use out of it for EPD. Okay? So really, to understand the general perspective of EPD, you have to understand where it fits in genetic improvement. So where it fits in, how do I make my next generation of animals better than what I currently have? What are the right selection decisions, and how can I do that to the best of my ability, make that prediction and improve my animal's performance in that next generation? Well, really, to understand that, you have to know something about the perspective and the factors that influence how quickly we make genetic improvement. And it turns out there's four things that determine how fast we make genetic improvement. And I should say that I'm taking the perspective where you've picked a specific trait, and usually for most of you there's more than one trait that's important relative to genetic improvement. But if you just pick one trait, let's say we want to improve fiber diameter, standard deviation of fiber diameter, or fleece weight. Okay, in that perspective, how could you improve that one trait? Okay, so think about the four factors. Okay, there are four things that influence how fast can I make progress, how fast can I make a next generation and a subsequent generation, another generation that is better than the current one. Okay, the first of those is selection intensity. That is, how picky are you at choosing which animals go into the breeding program? Okay, so if you're focused on fiber diameter, how picky are you in fiber diameter and the genetics or the performance of that animal to put into your breeding program? to try to make genetic. How much better is it than the rest of the population is another way to think about that. Okay. The next one is generation interval. And this is something you have complete control over as breeders and managers, but essentially how quickly do you put in young superior animals? And what I'm talking about is, do I keep producing and breeding my older animals, or am I focusing on maybe pulling them out of the breeding population, but really sticking in the new best genetics from both a male and a female side? So in general, generation interval, if you're making progress, the quicker you put in new animals, the faster your rate of progress. On intensity, the more picky you are in selecting the animals that come in into your breeding program for the trait you want to improve, the faster you're going to make genetic change. Okay? So again, we're focusing on one trait, and how fast can we make improvement in that trait. Now, the next thing is really something we have little control over. Okay, from a national alpaca herd or breeding program, genetic variability is pretty set. In the absence of new importations or something along those lines, the genetic variability we have to work with as a population of animals, is pretty set. But it does influence rate of genetic progress. Okay, and typically you would want variability high because it allows you to select very extreme animals animals, for instance, for fiber diameter that are on the outlier or an outlier on the tails of a distribution. But typically, this is one we really can't worry about a whole lot because there's not a lot to do. And then there's accuracy of selection. And how good are we at selecting the animals with the best genetics? So I'm sure you've all done it. I've done it where I thought, man, that male, he's excellent for whatever trait it is, and you breed him. And you get the offspring born, and they don't do as well as you thought they should do, right? I mean, we always have a normal distribution, and some are below average, and some are better. But you're really trying to push genetic progress. So how good are we at selecting that? And in EPDs, it makes this easy because we actually report an accuracy value with those EPDs. And that helps us determine where do I put most faith relative to a prediction about an animal's genetic merit. So when we start to think about EPDs and where they really help us in this context of these four things, there's really two places that this helps us. That's in intensity, because we widen the pool of animals from which we can select breeding animals and do that with reliability. And then there's accuracy of selection. With EPD, because we're incorporating, as you will see, more data than would be typically available to you as a breeder, okay, on a nationwide basis, you really have some ability to select the animals that have the best genetics and do that with a fair degree of accuracy. Okay, now, so with that setting, those 4 points, putting that in context, really your ability to make improvement in whatever trait you think would help your breeding program and your animals and make you more profitable, it really depends upon accuracy of selection. Okay, we can be picky, but if that pickiness, that selection intensity, isn't fairly accurate, we're really not going to make as fast a progress as we think. So to increase our rates of progress, how fast we make genetic improvement in subsequent generations, above just taking a phenotypic observation, so an observation on one individual and one sample, so you sent off a fleece weight samples on the animals in your breeding program, and you look at what comes back from Yoke and McCall. Hey, that's valuable information, but there's a way to actually maximize that and leverage that data in the form of genetic prediction and ultimately EPD. Because as you're going to see, it pulls in data from a lot of other animals that you may never have seen, never have been on their farm, but we know through genetic relationships that that's valuable. It tells us something about animals' genetics. So that's our perspective. We got four things that determine how fast we make progress. Okay, the two biggest ones from our standpoint as managers is selection intensity, how picky we are, and how good we are at selecting the animals with the best genetics, our accuracy. Okay, so now I'm going to step back with that as the overview and talk a little bit about the basic biology of EPD. Okay, performance, we academicians call it phenotype, you know, how an animal performs, how it looks, okay, is really a function of two things. The environment, okay, the climate, the weather, how you feed the animals, how often you shear the animals, plus genetics. Okay? And from the standpoint of EPD, it's the genetics that we're interested in. Environment management is kind of noise in this system, okay? So the question then becomes, when we look at things we want to improve in our alpaca breeding program, all the various traits, whether they have EPDs or don't have EPDs, really the question is, how important is genetics to animal performance? The indicator or the number we put towards that importance is heritability. Okay, so we've got an animal's performance as a function of its genetics and its environment. Okay, genetics, in most cases, influences performance. There are traits where genetics really doesn't play a huge role, but most of what we're interested in production is influenced by genetics. So that's what we see, and we want to know how much of what we see is influenced by genetics. Okay, and we call that heritability, and this is what heritability is. So if we go through the audience that's out here and we take a height measurement on everybody, okay? Not everybody's the same. I'm probably below the distribution, and there's a number of you that are above the average, okay? Or I'm below average. Okay, that's variability. So when we look at alpacas for fiber diameter, and you walk through the barn, there's differences in fiber diameter, there's differences in how much fleece they produce, that's variability. It's what we see, okay? Heritability tells us how much of that is due to genetics that were passed from parent to offspring. How much big of an influence is that? That's heritability. And heritability plays a key role in calculating EPDs, and we're going to see that later on. Okay? Now, so that's heritability. So that's a ratio, right? It ranges from 0 to 1. Now, if we look at the heritabilities for alpaca data, for the variety of traits, and we do this separately between Huacayas and Surreys, okay, and we just redid it actually here a couple years ago in 2013, two analyses ago. You look at the heritabilities for the various traits for which we have data and produce EPDs. They're pretty high. Typically, we think of a low heritability as less than 20%. Trait that's moderately influenced by genetics is 20 to 40%. A trait that's highly influenced by genetics is above 40%, okay? And I work a lot with my job at in Colorado State with providing these EPD services to beef cattle breed associations. And in history, we've also done some hunting dog evaluations. The concept's the same, but you look in alpaca, most of the traits you see here, either for Huacaya or Surrey, are at the top end of what we would see in any other livestock species. Right, so 50% heritable, you know, there's only probably two things in the beef industry that are 50% heritable: mature weight and some of the carcass characteristics. Okay, that shows how much genetic improvement you have. And if you look at the dairy industry, and you know, what is it? In the last 30 years or 40 years, we've tripled the production of milk from Holstein cattle through selection and better management. Right? Well, the heritability of milk production in Holstein cattle is about 35%. So you've got way more variability to work with in this population. So we should be able to, if you want to change a trait, we have the opportunity to do that because these heritabilities are phenomenal. It tells us the value of the information we're collecting and how we can put that in an EPD program should give us pretty good rapid rates of change. I mean, we have a lot of opportunity there in both Huacaya and Surrey. So what I just said, genetic change could be rapid. I get rolling and get ahead of myself, so you guys will have to bear with me. Given the heritability, there's a lot of opportunity. If your breeding program isn't where you want it for a particular trait, there's a lot of opportunity to make good genetic improvement and get it where you want it. Okay, so the components of genetics. Not sure why that went off screen. Okay, genetics. Now, there's two pieces of genetics, actually, okay, and EPD represent one of those. Okay, one is additive value, that's EPD, and the other one is what we call non-additive value. And non-additive value, you can think of it this way. You pick the best males for their genetics for fiber diameter or staple length, whatever the case may be, and you use them in your breeding program. They're passing genes on. Who you mate that male to, the female, and how those genes combine is that lower one, that non-additive value. Dr. Rick Borden calls it gene combination value, and that's kind of the newer terminology adopted over the last decade. But it's the way genes are combined in the individual. But because it's the way they pair, that's not passed on to the next generation. So we focus on this additive value, passing on half the genes act in the progeny, and they perform differently than the average because of the genes they got from their mother and the genes they got from their sire. Okay? So a little bit about basic terminology. Okay? We said additive genetic value in the individual, we call it breeding value, the value of that animal for breeding. But for EPDs, we know only half of those genes are going to get passed on to the next generation. Okay? So that half, that average half of the genes, is what we call progeny difference. Okay? That's where the EPD is. It represents the contribution of a parent to the next generation. And you guys know there's variability associated with that, right? If you've got full sibs, you realize you and your brothers and sisters are not all alike, right? Because of that randomness of inheritance. But on average, right, you are half of your parents' genetics and half of your mother's, and that mean is what we're predicting, okay? We're still going to get some variability in EPD, but that mean is what we're predicting. Now, EPD then represent half of an animal's genetics because it's what's going to the next generation. That's why we call it progeny differences, okay? And so we're predicting performance in the next generation, the genetic merit of those individuals. And like I alluded to, there's some deviations, okay? And you're going to get some variability just because of Mendel's laws. When you went through basic biology and we talked about the peas, there was variability in the peas, right? Because sometimes one gene of a pair got passed on as opposed to another. EPDs account for that, okay? But we're working on averages for the most part, okay? Now, when we think about EPD, we got to remember it's a prediction of an animal's true genetic merit. We never know the true genetics. Even with all of the genome mapping that's been done in humans and the livestock industries, we that's where all the research is. We kind of capture some of that. You can't predict an outcome. We just know that predict an exact outcome of an animal's of a person's genes and what will happen to them in the future. It just doesn't work that way. Okay? We make a prediction, and I hate to use this analogy, but it's like, you know, during election season, you watch the news and you get these polls, and there's a plus or minus 3%, so there's error associated with that prediction, or there's plus or minus 5%. Well, there's error with EPDs. They're not perfect, but they incorporate more information and are better than we can select on our own from a genetic improvement standpoint. So they're predictions of genetic merit, and they work on averages. Okay, so with that as the background, when we get the data from AOA and we do the calculations that come up with EPD, okay, our goal is to make fair predictions, okay, about every animal that's in the population and help you or give you a tool, one of the tools in your toolbox to select the best animals for breeding. Okay, now to do that, we've got to factor out the environmental influences, right, because that's not passed on. You know, you may have bought a particular male from a particular breeding program, or you may buy something here at the national sale and bring it home. You're not buying it for the way it was raised and how well it was fed. You're buying it for the genes it's going to pass on to your next generation of progeny. Okay, and we'll talk more about how we factor out environmental influences later on. But in the end, once we can kind of weed out, for geneticists like me, that environment's noise. Once we weed that out, we've got EPDs, okay? And that's where they come from, okay? So in the context of developing the best animal, okay, you have to realize in not one trait is the trait to select on, okay? So give you an example. In the dairy industry, you know, everything's, well, we have to produce more and more milk. Well, in some you also have to have a dairy cow that lasts a while and keeps lactating. Right? So there's a trait, longevity, that's important. Or how much fat and how much protein's in that milk. In the same case works for alpaca, right? You may want fineness. We've got uniformity to worry about in those fibers. We've got density and the staple length. Then we got fleece weight. How much do they produce? And then you got conformation. But wait a minute, conformation, we don't have EPDs for that, right? So you got to weigh in that piece. So for each breeding program, it's important to you use EPDs in that context. Where do you want to end up? Where are you going with your breeding program? And what type of animal would you consider the best? Because that's going to help you focus on what traits are most important. You know, you may have fiber diameter where you want it already. Okay, so really your goal is just to keep it there, okay, rather than change it drastically. Or you may have pretty good uniformity. But it's up to each person's breeding program how best to use these. They mean the same, but obviously not all of us are going to have the same traits that are important. Okay, so quick example on interpretation. I pulled these out of the last analysis, and I used fiber diameter. When we talk about EPD, okay, we can't say sire A's minus 1.9 fiber diameter EPDs always going to give us 18 micron fiber diameter. You can't say that because environment plays a role. So when we interpret EPD, we're really worried about the difference. Okay, what is the difference? So I can choose A or I can choose B to put into my breeding program. In that next generation, on average, what am I expecting relative to the difference of those two sires' genetics? Okay, should I choose one over the other? And if you do this, all you have to do is take a difference. And the difference between a negative 1.9 and a plus 0.2 is 2.1. So on average, okay, we assume that progeny of sire A, okay, or we're predicting, based on the genes that A has and passes to the next generation, that those progeny will average 2.1 micron smaller fiber diameter than if those animals had been sired by B. Okay? And when we compare these, we're assuming you could in the end use both of these animals, but we're also assuming in this prediction that they're getting mated to similar females, because the females are contributing to those genetics as well. Okay? And we're also assuming that difference, that they're in the same environment. Because you know as well as I do, there's a lot of these traits we can modify with management, and we could give one preferential treatment or preferential feed that might bias the results. But this is breaking it down into just genetics. Okay, what we would expect relative to those progeny performance based on genes passed from A or genes passed from B. Okay. And I've already said sires mated to females of similar genetics merit. So you're giving them this fair shake, fair competition. Okay, one A doesn't just get mated to the best females, and B doesn't get mated to the worst females. You got to give them a fair shake in that prediction, not necessarily in your actual mating plan, but when we're comparing the differences. Okay, now with preferential mating, this may not hold because we're not, in this example, we're not accounting for the differences in genetics from the female. Okay, so we're just looking solely at the genes the parents, the sires pass on. Okay, we can account for the female, but we need to know her EPD as well. Okay, so some key points. When you interpret EPD, it's always the difference. An EPD on one animal really doesn't tell you a lot unless you know who you're comparing it to. Okay, or you're comparing it to the average of your herd. Okay. The same assumptions apply for all the traits. I picked on fiber diameter, use that as the example. Okay, again, we're predicting an average merit of the progeny with EPD. And assumptions apply to all those other traits for which we have EPD. Okay. Now, a question, having given these talks and given them to other industries, what does zero mean? Okay. Well, if I look across all the different species that we raise in the U.S. from the standpoint of ranching or farming, my answer is it depends. Because it depends upon which breed and which species we're talking about. Dairy industry has a moving base. Okay? In your analysis, okay, this is what's the most important. In your analysis, zero EPD. Okay? If we go back to those original importations, okay, where they came in the U.S., we consider those what we call foundation animals. They're the foundation of our industry in the U.S. and in North America. Okay, if you average their genetics for whatever trait, that's the base. Okay, so it's the average genetic merit of an individual or all the individuals originally imported for fiber diameter, that's a zero EPD. So you can compare where you're at now with the average of all those original imports just by looking at the EPD. If you're at a minus 2.1 in your breeding program, you're producing fleece or fiber that is 2.1 microns smaller than the average of all those original importations. Okay? So it gives you kind of an idea where you're at. So what we do is, you'll see in the data, is we, when Darby and Dee send us information, we trace all the pedigrees back on those animals that we have data on to the original importation, at least three generations if that's possible. And so we want to capture all of that information to know where we started and where are we now. Okay. Now, so let's work through a couple other examples. And I'm picking on fleece weight. And I wiped out the animals' names just to not confuse the issue. But in the EPDs, these are all Hokaias. They're all males. And you might want be concerned in your breeding program about how much fleece they're actually producing. And so I'm not sure if you can see it, but the top EPD for that very top one, let me go back. Well, let's start with the bottom. The bottom one's about 0.129. That's its fleece weight EPD. Okay. The top one's EPD is 0.992. So if we wanted to choose between these two males and we're worried about improving fleece weight, trying to get more fleece, you choose the top one. And on average, his progeny would produce, what is that, 0.992 minus 0.129, about 0.86 pounds more fleece on average than if they were the progeny were sired by that bottom one that I've circled. So it gives us an idea to predict what are the genetics, the genes that that sire's passing on, and it's always the difference that's important. And then if we go through another one and look at standard deviation of fiber diameter, that bottom one has a minus 2.83, and the one above it has a 0.702, and so, you know, what are we at? 0.42 difference. Now, standard deviation doesn't have units, whereas if we go back, fleece weight was in pounds. Standard deviation is just in standard deviation units. So we're about, what is that? About pushing half a standard deviation difference in fiber diameter, okay, when we look at the variability. But again, it's the differences that count. Now, gone on the website, looked at the EPDs for your animal, you figured out there's always an accuracy. Okay? And accuracy tells us how good are we at predicting an animal's breeding value or its genetics and what it's going to pass to the next generation. And it ranges from 0 to 1. We never get to 1. There are bulls in the dairy industry that have hundreds of thousands of progeny, and the accuracy is still 0.99. That's a theoretical best. We just never know all about an animal's genetics. Okay? But the closer to 1 we are, the more data that's gone into that EPD and the more confidence we have in that EPD. And I'm going to show you what this relates to. Accuracy were developed to make ranking animals on how much we knew about them easier. Okay? So 0 to 1, you could always just the higher, they're more accurate. Okay? And it was an easy interpretation, but really what we're trying to represent is possible change. And that kind of goes back to those poles we talked about where there's a standard error, plus or minus 5%. So you take an animal that was born last year and you take a fiber or a fleece sample and send that into Yoakum McCall and you get your first set of data. Okay? That tells us something about that animal's genetics compared to everybody else in your breeding program. Okay? That's one observation. But then you use that animal in your breeding program and you get 10 progeny next year and you grow them up and you send in a fleece sample to Yoakum McCall. Now we got 10 observations on progeny that were sired by the same animal. That tells us more about his genetics. Okay? And so really possible change tells us, here's our best estimate now. How much might that change as we get more data into the system? That EPD is not going to stay the same. And you figured out from one run to the next, EPD change, right? And so what we can do then is translate that accuracy to this possible change. How much change is there going to be? And what this does from a practical application is tell you how much risk is there. If I select a young animal where I've really only got one fiber sample set in and only that information, right? As he gets progeny or she gets progeny, how much will that change? How confident are we in that EPD based on one observation that represents that animal's genetics? Okay, so we can calculate, and this gets a little statistical, we can calculate a 67% chance we're right or a 95 or a 99, but we're gonna stick with the 67, one possible change. Okay, so here is the possible change table for Hokkaido. Okay, and you can see on the left that as accuracy goes from the top of zero, where we really know nothing about that animal, down to one, okay, where we, as we approach one, we get perfect prediction of that animal's genetic merit. And I'll stick with fiber diameter, but you'll notice at low accuracy, as you move down that column, what do we see? The amount that that animal's EPD should change gets smaller and smaller and smaller. Because we have a lot of information, we're becoming more precise in that prediction. Okay? So, ultimately, in the perfect world, we get to a zero. Never happens in any species. Okay? We get a lot that are close. So, how could you use possible change? All right, so let's say we've got an animal that has a minus 1.1 fiber diameter, and it has an accuracy of 0.65. Okay, so let's go back to the table. 0.65 is halfway between 0.6 and 0.7. Okay, well let's just round it up to 0.7. So I'll go to that accuracy table at 0.7 on the left side. The trait we're working with is fiber diameter. I'll get that value, okay, which is 0.35. All right, and I want to know how much change might I expect in that EPD as this animal gets more progeny or more information. Okay, so I take that 0.35 from the 0.7 accuracy, so I use that value, and I add it and I subtract it to the animal's EPD. Okay, and that gives us the range that's in the bottom. So in this animal, right, the fiber diameter EPD is negative. Well, wait a minute, it's negative, so that means it's better than the average of all those original importations. Okay, so I'm reducing fiber diameter, and my confidence is that that animal's true progeny difference, its true genetic merit, is in that range of a negative 1.45, okay, to 0.75, negative 0.75. So as we get more information, with 67% confidence, we should fall in that range. And we could construct a wider one that gives us 95% surety that we're in that range, and you just multiply possible change times 2, okay? But it's a measure of risk. And it gets mathematical, and really, you know, if you're a person who likes numbers like I do, it's pretty cool, right? But really, in the end, all we need to worry about is that accuracy, okay? That animal's accuracy was pretty high at a 0.7. We have a lot of faith in that animal, okay? Now, okay, so that's how you interpret EPDs. It's always the difference, unless you want to compare it to the base of the population, which is zero EPD, and see where that animal is relative to the average of those foundation animals. And every EPD has an accuracy. And as the accuracy goes from 0 to 1 and gets higher, we have more faith in that animal's genetic evaluation, that animal's EPD for that trait. Okay? Now, so what do we do? How do we do this? How do we actually get EPD? And what we use to calculate this is what you submit. Okay? And so we've got your pedigree information from when you register the animal. We've got information about the individual. What is the sex? When was it born? And once we know when it's born, every sample you send in or every piece of data, we can calculate an age, provided you've submitted a date with when that sample was taken. And then we get two types of individual performance data. Some that comes from Yoakum McCall when you send in a fleece sample. Okay, and then there's the stuff you submit, the breeder submitted data. So the fleece weight, we'll talk about this in a minute, and the birth weights, they're all data that you've submitted directly, okay? And then comes to us, and we use that to predict an animal's merit, genetic merit. And then finally, contemporary group, okay? And so that's, we know this animal was on this farm in this year, and they submitted the fiber sample, or the fleece sample, and this data occurred on this farm in this year. We also know, if you submit more than one sample, that the other animals were competing against this animal. So it helps us start to rank the genetics of those individuals. And then we factor out year differences, because weather changes. One year we'll have a wet year and a lot of forage, and another year it'll be a dry year, and those have that influences our fiber characteristics. Okay? And it actually influences birth weight, right? How the mother's fed while she's gestating that crea. Okay? So we account that saying that within a year, animals have had the same opportunity to express their genetics, and therefore we can compare that information. Okay? So what's I've listed all of the data that we're using currently in the EPD calculations, and then everything above those bottom two comes from Yoko McCall when you send in a sample. Okay, and we use all of that. Right, we're going to use all the information that we get. And so, you know, I've done a lot of EPDs over the course of my career. I'm hopefully not done yet doing EPDs and helping breeders make better selection decisions. But the data growth in alpaca has been nothing short of phenomenal, in my opinion. I mean, we're seeing continuing growth rates and how much information we have in that database to actually calculate EPD. And it's quite satisfying for somebody who does EPD, because it's clear you're interested, because we're getting tons and tons of data. And you know, when we originally started, we got tons of information on older animals that you had run fiber samples on and got data, and it just added value to the EPD. And so we're pushing 20,000, 19,000 observations in Wakaya for fiber diameter, and you can look here for the rest of the traits. And then Surreys are also growing at about the same rate as Wakaya. They started with a little less data, but they're growing at the same rate. So I'm every time I get a new data set from Darby and D, I'm tickled pink. Is like, how much more data do they have? And so that's kind of the nerd in me, looking at numbers and data. Okay, now birth weight and for both of those is a little bit less. Okay, and probably hasn't been the trait quite as much interest as the fiber characteristics, and that's understandable. But it's still growing at phenomenal rates as well. Okay, so very satisfying from the standpoint of somebody who calculates EPD. Okay. One of the concepts that's important for EPD is this idea of contemporary group. And to really get good EPD, we need to know who competed head-to-head in the same environment, in the same year, and you fed the same. Okay, you treated the same. So a lot of the environmental factors wash out, and really those differences in performance are more likely due to genetics they carry rather than some managerial aspect. So we devise something called a contemporary group. And so I go through the data and I pull out the farm, and I combine that with the year they were born in, and we start to build this contemporary group, so we're only comparing animals that, at least in my standpoint, have had the same opportunity to express genetic differences. And that's a contemporary group, and that's key to any of these evaluations, because we don't know what the effect of another inch of rain on your pasture growth is and how that translates into a change in fiber diameter. We just know all of the animals on your farm had that same experience and had the same ability to express their genetic differences. Okay, so that's one of the components we factor out and try, and we use data relative to who they competed against. And then, as you're going to see, we factor in all of the relationships amongst individuals. Okay, so what I've got here are three groups of animals, and I don't care. The illustration's the same whether this is three groups of animals from your farm. And the left block is ones that were born in 2010, and the middle block was in 2011, and the other block was in 2012. Doesn't matter. Or it's one sample from three of the breeders in here from diverse parts of the U.S. Okay. So if we take those, that circle represents a contemporary group. And what I'm trying to illustrate is how we start to factor out these environmental differences. Okay. So let's say in both of those groups or herds, they use the same sire. So they've got offspring in both performing in both herds. Okay? And this sire has offspring in two groups. Okay? And that sire only has a representation in one group. Okay? So hopefully this is starting to illustrate, well, wait a minute, in that center group, it's really a key group because we have progeny of all three sires competing in the same environment, right? So we're giving them a head-to-head, their progeny a head-to-head comparison. But what that allows us to do, oh, and I forgot sire four. He's only represented in that group. Okay? So what do we know? If we look at A6 and A1, they share 25% of their genes in common. So the half-sibs share their genes. Well, if they share genes, they should perform alike. Okay? Well, they don't in those two groups if the management's different. But we kind of know they should perform alike, so this much must be due to the way the center breeder manages their animal, that center box. Okay? And we also know that because we have a head-to-head comparison in that one group, we can actually fairly compare sire 2's genetics with sire 4 because we have that tie group. Okay? Now, if you run a breeding program where you are isolated, you never bring in outside animals, that makes comparisons to other genetics in the alpaca population difficult. And I haven't seen that in your data set, but we know in other industries we have certain breeders, and there's not many, that they run a closed herd. They never bring in any new genetics. So how do we get those in the EPDs? Well, if they sell any animals to breeding herds in other locations, that establishes that genetic tie, okay, and tells us something about their genetic merit. So we could still compare their genetics to other folks' genetics that may have had more widely used or a more diverse sample of genetics in the alpaca population. Now, hey, this is going to shift down a little bit. Okay, so this is our population. We just looked at sires. But then we could go back another generation. We figure out the mother of sire 1 and 2 is the same animal. Okay, so that tells us more about how these animals are related and how her grand progeny are related. So if we look at this, we're building that pedigree back, trying to account for all of the relationships amongst animals. And when we do that, it pulls in more animals that get EPD. Okay? And we know just based on that addition, if we look at A6 and A7, they share a 16th of their genes in common. And that tells us more about how that left block contemporary group or left side contemporary group and right side contemporary group perform. Okay? That tells us a lot about their performance and tells us they're related. If you have the same genes, you should perform alike. So it helps us start to weed out the environmental effects that are inherently unique to each of those groups. Okay? Now, how do we do that? Okay. At a very rudimentary level, I'm gonna flashback you to eighth grade algebra. I think it was eighth grade. Right? You had three equations, three unknowns, had to solve for X, Y, and Z. Right? Had to find out what those were and solve. So you solve for X, then you substituted what you found for X into the next one, and you solve for Y, and then you substitute that in the bottom one, and eventually you came up with an answer. Okay, that's very similar to what we do in the EPD calculations, except we may know that X and Y and Z are related based on that previous slide. So we have to factor in that relationship. But in your situation, in the alpaca, it's not three equations, three unknowns. In one, I think the last alpaca run is right at 150,000 equations, 150,000 unknowns. Okay, that's why we use computers. You know, I could start that and try to do it by hand, and I'd be long gone before we ever got there. But the computing power that we're leveraging from Silicon Valley, if you will, has really helped us do this. Okay, in the Surrey evaluation, it's 33,000 equations, 33,000 unknowns, and that's just for one or two traits. Okay, so it's a lot of computing. And in that, part of what we do is, just like what I showed in the previous slide, we actually go back, if you submit data, and this is your first year of submitting this animal's data, we go back and trace that pedigree back to the original importation, or a minimum of four generations if that's appropriate. Okay, because we want to leverage all of that information and how those animals are related. And it takes a fair bit of computing to actually get this done. But that's how we do it, okay, at a very rudimentary level. Now, what about environmental effects? Okay, the key point to remember in the standpoint of EPD is environment's not passed on. You buy an animal here, you're buying it for its genetics, right? What's it going to help me do in my breeding program? Okay, so you're buying that animal, passes on genes to the progeny. Those genes are expressed that influence its performance. In some cases, there are what we call maternal effects. And so that's the effect of genes in a mother that she expresses. So think of milk production. She has genetics that tell her how much milk to produce, genetics that determine how fast the fetus grows in utero. Okay, she expresses those. But if you're if you're her progeny, right, you're her chria, for you it's environment. Goodness, how much milk do I have to drink? So how fast can I grow? And how fast can I partition that into my growth and fleece growth and a whole host of other things? It's genetic in the dam. Okay. At this stage, we don't include maternal effects because of, as you're going to see, some of the restrictions on data. That's something we will probably look at in the future, is how do we account better for maternal effects on chria performance. Okay, and maybe there are none. Maybe when you get out to 8 years of age, mom's effect has nothing to do with my own performance, which is probably likely, realistically. So that's one area, and as I say to a lot of the people we work with, there's never a perfect evaluation. We just keep getting better and better as we learn more. And I want to be honest with you. I come to these meetings, and I've gone to some producer meetings in local region around Fort Collins and elsewhere, and I learn a lot from these because people say, well, have you considered this? Well, I don't raise alpaca, but then it makes me think, well, how could we account for that to make this a better genetic evaluation? So I value your input. And over the years, in alpaca, a number of people have said, Shauna and a whole host of others, we've actually incorporated saying, look, we aren't accounting for that. How can we make that better? So when you have questions, that actually helps me make a better evaluation for you all. Okay? So in this process, contemporary group or animals that compete head-to-head, okay, we also adjust for the age at which that fiber sample and those observations were taken. Okay? And this is not linear, so as they age, we don't expect a consistent change in fiber characteristics throughout the animal's entire life. It's curvilinear, okay? And in the basic research when we set this up, it is curvilinear. I mean, it's a nonlinear relationship, so the effect of age as an animal goes from 1 to 2 to 3 to 8 to 10 or however long, okay? We need to adjust for that because that's not genetic, right? That's environmental. Just because in this year I've got observations on a 4-year-old animal versus a 2-year-old, okay, we need to weed that out from a genetic standpoint because they're still just going to pass on half their genes. The other thing we do is we adjust for sex differences. Okay, we actually can account for those for each of the traits, and I'll show you what some of the solutions are coming out of your analysis, and then how old was the mother. Okay, so in your evaluation, okay, for things we know differences about, we can actually come up with a solution. So this was for fleece weight. And I think this was out of your last evaluation. I went in, and I can't remember whether it was Hawkeye or Surrey, but looked at what does the difference in fleece production if you're a male versus a female versus a gelding. Okay? And in this, just illustrating how we adjust for these things that we consider environmental, okay, a male, consider it average. In general, females produce a little over a pound less of fleece based on the data in your data set. So not as much fleece produced. Gelding's about a quarter of a pound less than your average male. Okay? And we can do that because you submit the sex. We actually include that in our statistics and we come up with how do we account for the fact that this animal's a male, this animal's a female, but they're both passing on genes for fiber diameter. Okay, but the male, because of the testosterone, a whole host of other things that are physiological, may produce more fleece, right? But just being a male, we want to know what's getting passed on to that next generation. And we need to account for this. We consider this an environmental effect. Okay? So the other question I get is sometimes, you know, well, I know you get back from Yoko McCall, the CV values. Okay? Well, CV are not in the EPD because they're really just a function of two EPDs, the average and a standard deviation. So reporting a CV really clouds the issue, a CV EPD for CV, because we've already captured all of those genetics in average fiber diameter, for instance, and standard deviation of fiber diameter. Okay, so you won't see those, okay, but because they're a function of the other two EPDs. Okay, and we wanted to make selection from the standpoint of breeders easier, so if that's something you're worried about, you can actually calculate that based on the EPDs, okay? Now, so this is what we get. Hawkeye EPD, we get what is the average and then the minimum and the maximum, and they're spread in the EPD, in the last two analyses, we started sorting out males and females. And we do this for Surrey as well, okay? So it gives you an idea when you look at females, because originally, and when we started this, we put all of the sexes in one listing, okay? Well, sires tend to sort themselves out because we have more information and they have higher accuracy, so we get a better spread in the EPD. But really, if we want to know what is the spread in females and where do my animals rank, that's why we split up the males and the females. And we do it for both Wakaya and Surrey, and you get an idea also of the average accuracy and the maximum accuracies. And you can see on average, let's go back here, well, we can use Surrey as well, either one. Males tend to have more accuracy than females. Just the way it is. They produce so many more progeny on average that we're gonna see higher accuracies for males and females, and definitely higher maximum accuracies. Just a function of the way the data is structured and where all of the information comes from. Okay? Now, so what I want to do now is tie this back to heritability. We've got the EPDs. All good and well. We know how to interpret those. But you told me originally, heritability tells us how much of what we see is due to genetics. Okay? Well, we incorporate those heritabilities into the genetic evaluation. And what heritability influences is the spread in those EPDs. Okay? If we just took fiber diameter and I think, 52% heritable. If theoretically it was only 20% heritable, our minimum and maximum range would shrink. Because we would say, based on what we know, not as much of that is genetics. So going back to heritability, we use that to determine how much spread in EPD should we get for those given accuracies. And the lower heritability traits, we get less spread. Thankfully, in alpaca, your traits are so heritable, we really get a good spread on animals' genetics and a good prediction, because heritability, genetics, additive genetics plays such a big role in what we observe. Okay, so I pulled out the minimum and the maximum shown here. That's for fiber diameter. Can't remember if it's Surrey or Hokiya. The heritability is 0.5. If the heritability of that trait were 0.2, you wouldn't see that spread from minimum to maximum. It says what we're seeing is not as much due to genetics because the heritability is lower. Okay? Now, the other piece I tried to illustrate, what do we use data on? Okay? There are really three pieces of data or sources of data that help us to calculate EPD. An animal's own performance, pedigree data, and when I'm talking about pedigree, I'm talking about relatives, okay? Back in the pedigree, so half sibs, full sibs, grandparents, great grandparents, great great grandparents, cousins, aunts, uncles. As long as animals share genetics, we're going to use that information in the analysis. They've got to have performance information, right? Or be directly related and have gotten genes to an animal that has had data submitted. And then finally, progeny data. This is the most valuable data. Really the only way to prove an animal and get very high accuracy is to get observations on their progeny. And in my undergraduate breeding and genetics class, we actually look at the value of these two or these three things relative to each of those. You could get tens of thousands of observations, fiber characteristics on half sibs of an individual, but there's a ceiling to how valuable that is relative to accuracy. You really need progeny out of that individual to give us the best EPD possible. So in the ranking of these three, obviously as a young animal, own performance is most important before they ever have progeny. Getting an idea of how that animal performs, that tells us a lot. We'll factor in all of those collateral relatives if they have data. But ultimately, to really prove a sire, we need progeny. Or prove a dam. We need progeny to determine with a high degree of accuracy what those animals' genetics are. Okay? Now, the other piece about this evaluation is we try to leverage as much information as possible. So, for instance, okay, if we get, when we started this, fleece weight had the most data. Now it's been surpassed by some other traits. So I started out with fleece weight as our key piece of information because that's what we had as much as possible to work with. And then we have fiber diameter and average or standard deviation of fiber diameter data. We know that fleece weight has a genetic relationship to fiber diameter and has a genetic relationship to how much variability, standard deviation of fiber diameter. So what we try to do is leverage information on multiple traits, because we know they're related, to give us a better EPD. So for instance, you submit a fiber diameter sample, or a fiber diameter information, staple length information comes in. We'll use those two pieces of information to evaluate fleece weight as well. because they're genetically related. Now, we call that the genetic correlation. So you've probably figured out if you select one way for fiber diameter and forget everything else, you're still going to change some other traits, right? That's a genetic correlation, how we change those traits. And so, or how those traits are genetically related to another trait. Genetic correlations can be move one trait, the other one moves in the same direction, or move one trait and the other one goes the other direction. Doesn't matter. As long as there's a relationship, we can leverage information on multiple traits to produce an EPD for one trait, as long as they're genetically related. And in the process of developing these, and actually when we estimated the heritabilities the last time, there's a fair bit of genetic relationship amongst a lot of those traits that's going to tell us a lot about how the genes they have for a single trait. Because fiber diameter tells us something about fleece weight. Fleece weight tells us something about staple length. Okay? We leverage that in this analysis to give us the most accurate EPD possible. Okay. So that's a little bit of background on EPD. When you submit data, there's some things that I want to make you aware of. Okay, and there are just some things we filter out and ways to maximize your data. Most often asked question, okay? Wait a minute. The breeders are collecting all their fleece weights. What weight we get is going to depend on how they're handled, and they've done it different over the years. And we go back in history to the original importations when we first started. They've done it differently. Okay. You're right. We all know that. It could bias results. But what helps us is if you as breeders treated all those animals the same. Okay. And I think the current guidelines are actually address this in giving you some guidelines for fleece weight. But right now those guidelines say weigh everything, okay, to get the fleece weight. Historical data, not everything may have been weighed, okay? But if you didn't weigh the fleece from the legs, and you did that for all the animals in your breeding program within a particular year, it doesn't matter. It comes out in that contemporary group effect, okay? Now, if you weighed some fleece with the legs and without, that adds error. That isn't as useful a data. So my concern, the guidelines say you include the blanket, the neck, the apron, the belly, the legs, everything is in that fleece weight. My biggest concern is that when you shear those animals and you take that weight, that is done for all of the animals, okay? Because then it says that is a representation of our same measurement system, our same trait, okay? So that's what I often get asked is, well, fleece weight difference, breeders are submitting the data, okay? No, that's fair enough. But as long as you treat the animals the same, in that historic data, we were good. Okay? Going forward, we have guidelines for that, okay? Now, I'm going to need some help from the back to click. Okay, look, just a second here. So I want to give you an example. The other one we often see, and this is not unique to your industry, this is every industry. But you know what? I'm only going to present data on the good animals. Okay? That's all you're going to get. I'm not going to tell you my bad animals. Okay? In the long run, it hurts you for doing that, and I'll show you why. Okay? If we take a contemporary group, okay, click on that link, please. Okay, I'm going to have you do one more thing in a second, okay? So if we look at this, I took an example. Can you in the back see those numbers? No? Can you hit Control Plus? And that should expand it, I think, or hit the zoom. Yeah, can we go to, yeah, there you go. Okay, this is perfect. All right, so we've got 10 animals, and let's say this is your breeding program. You've submitted this data within a year. There's their fiber diameter. Okay. At a very basic level, the EPDs are going to say all of those animals competed head-to-head. So how did they do compared to average? So on the bottom line, okay, we've got an average of 24.8 and the average deviation 0, right? Because everybody is, that's the average. But then in that right column D, I calculated how different was that animal's performance, okay, for fiber diameter related to the average it competed against. And you're going to see like that number one animal is a minus 2.8, so it had 2.8 micron smaller fiber diameter than the average of that contemporary group. Or number eight was 7.2 microns above average. Okay, let's say you sheared those animals and that's all your data. Okay, so Darby, if you can help me out in just a second. On the bottom tab, there's sheet one. Let's go to sheet two. Okay, what if you think, you know what, I'm only going to send in the data on the best animals. Okay, and I'm not going to submit the data on that one that had 7.2 micron bigger than the others. Okay, so in this left one, and I know you can't see my pointer, but in columns B and C, same animals. That's what we had from the previous sheet. But let's go to the right on the selected animals where you only sent in part of the data within that year. Okay, what do we see happening? We see that animal number one, right, that first animal, it was 2.8 microns better than everybody competed against when we had all the data. But I only submitted the bottom or the top end of my data. I didn't submit the bad animals. Well, now what does it look like? It looks like average. It's not a fair representation because we really don't have a good idea of who they competed against. So really, you're hurting yourself within a year if we don't get all that data because it biases him down. He's better than that compared to everybody he competed against. And the other one, let's see, there was another... Oh, the number nine animal, okay, well, let's look at number three. In the whole population, it was better than average for fiber diameter, minus 0.8 micron. When you selectively report and do not report the bottom end, now he looks worse than average. So really, because he's got a two micron deviation above average, has larger fiber, when in the whole population, he was below average. And so from a contemporary group standpoint, we're comparing animals head-to-head that had the same opportunity to perform. Selectively reporting, and selectively reporting can bias the results. Now, let's be realistic. There's a cost with sending a fleece sample in, no doubt. Okay, but within an age category or within your new animals, I think this is the worst thing you can do is selectively report amongst the new animals that might go into your breeding program because it's unfairly going to bias the good ones because they're not really getting compared against everybody in the program. It poses a problem. Now, over time, that washes out because we know relationships. So somebody else, you may be selectively reporting data. Somebody else may be submitting all of the data on related animals, and it's going to come out in the wash. Okay, but eventually. But again, selectively reporting can be problematic from a genetic evaluation. And most people think it helps, but it actually can harm you as well. Yes, sir. I'm gonna rephrase your question. If I forget anything, you tell me, yell at me. Okay. So the question was if you couldn't hear, is gentleman's gone through and submitted fiber samples on animals, you know, that are now 10 years old and done that every year. Is there value in submitting an 11th year? Let's say, in that scenario, under a limited financial restriction, I'm not sure you're gaining a lot. I'd rather spend that fleece weight or the fiber testing money on getting a complete sample of your younger animals. 10 observations give us a lot of information for EPD. So the question is, you've done that every animal every year. I'd say you have a good genetic evaluation because that's the kind of data we're looking for. Okay. The question is, once an animal hits 10, how much influence are they going to have after 10 observations on your breeding program? You probably know pretty well where they're at genetically. Now, I'm not going to tell you not to submit, not to keep doing that, because if you've been doing it, there must be some value, and I like data. Okay, but finances are finances. I mean, the animals you have the least information on are the ones where you get the most value. After 10 observations, and you've probably seen it if you looked at the EPDs over time, really submitting an 11th observation or submitting that 10th observation on this individual didn't change accuracy a whole lot, right? Typically, once you get up to 10, there's not a lot of change going from 10 to 11 and above. And in fairness to you all, I haven't done the math at where that accuracy starts. Not much value in that is in the scheme of things. Now, I like all of the data. That's the best way you can do that. But really, if you're pulling an animal out of your breeding program, we'll never use them again, even though they're still there. I'm not sure fleece or fiber characteristics tells you much. Okay. Sorry. The question was, you've got good microns in years 2 and years 3, but if they're out 10, 11, that micron's changed just to the age factor. Okay, I don't know the answer to your question. I've had a number of breeders tell me that animals change fiber characteristics over time at different rates. So as they age, what happens to micron changes differently amongst different animals. Okay, without that data, now I'm looking forward, without that data on those older animals, we're really never going to have a way to determine if that's genetic or not. So I like the older data, just looking ahead to future AOA evaluation, because there may be a difference in how things change from a rate standpoint. So how fast do they get larger micron size? Does that answer your question? Okay. Yeah. And we need that data. So, I mean, from you, it may not up the accuracy as much because you've submitted 10 samples on that animal. But from the standpoint of all of the alpacas in this country, that's going to add something eventually if we start looking at what is the rate and change in fiber characteristics. Yes, ma'am. I'm half deaf. Sorry. If you don't mind me walking around, I'm going to give you...
My question is, would it help to make like standard ages where we would do the fleece things, like maybe everyone do it at the age of 2, 6, and 10 and older? Would that help make the comparisons? And then it would be this, I mean, that would be a recommendation. Farms don't have to do it, but it would keep statistics closer.
So the question is, would it help if there were standard ages for animals to have the fiber characteristics measured? So that's a good question. I like more data, so the problem with a recommendation like that is that's probably all you're going to get. And so from looking at the future of the alpaca industry and what we can do from genetic evaluation, I'm not necessarily in favor of that, but for financial reasons, I can understand the logic associated with that. And it would standardize things and may cheapen things up, but from looking forward to the future in genetic evaluation, I'm not necessarily for that. The question is, as they age and you're selecting for sustained fineness, it does. But right now in the evaluations, we consider that process of aging, and I'm going to be honest, as a consistent process as a function of age. The more and more I talk to breeders, that may not be the case. Fiber characteristics change at different rates as animals age. The thing I don't know and I have not seen is if that is genetic. Yes. Eventually, we'll do the research for that. But so the question is, if you're selecting for sustained fineness and year after year after year, it comes in with a smaller micron fiber diameter, is that going to influence the EPD? Yes, it's going to keep it low. In some cases, as animals age, if that was genetic, okay, and not just this environment as a function of ages, it would creep those EPDs up. That would be another tool, yes, sir. As in time moving forward, if we could show that aging process had a genetic component, just not the passage of time, but and physiology of animals changing and reaching maturity, but there's a genetics component in the difference between animals that do very well at 2 and 3 versus 10 and 11. If that we could show that's genetic, that is a potential tool in the EPD in the future, and it may be. I got to think of what we call that, rate EPD, rate to fiber change EPD, something like that. But it is possible. And we have, in other livestock species, we have techniques that do that, look at fattening. Because as animals, you feed them, different animals put on fat at different rates. And for those of you who like a good steak, you know, you've got the select and the choice and the certified Angus and then the prime. The rate at which they hit those those different grades and qualities. Some will never hit prime or certified Angus. They just don't have the genetics to fatten. Okay, but it takes different amounts of time on feed to hit that. So in this, you're saying it takes different amounts of time for the fiber to change characteristics over an animal's life. It's a longer time span than what we do in other livestock species. If that's genetic, and we've shown it in other livestock species for fat, completely different trait, let's be honest, but, right? If it's genetic, there is a possibility to get an EPD for that. I'm going to go behind you. Yes, ma'am. So if you've never sent samples in for EPD, okay, here's our current samples or old samples most valuable. Old samples is the animal still on your farm, okay? Because if it's out of the breeding program and you have a limited amount of time and a little amount of data, I want the animals that are still there and then new samples moving in. If it's just a matter of moving the data over and there's not a lot of process on your time, I'd like it all, okay? But we've got to be realistic. Darby, I'm going to, if he's listening, are there restrictions on how far back in the association you could submit data on animals? Okay, so it would still be, okay. Yeah, if you've got data and it's old data, it goes in. Now, that's going to change because I'm going to pull in all the pedigree on your animals back to the original importation. You're going to have a whole host of animals that may have influenced your breeding program. And if it was just yours, you're going to need EPDs on those. They may already have EPD, but your data will add value to the EPD on those animals that are already in the evaluation. Because if an animal doesn't have an observation or isn't an ancestor of an animal with an observation, it doesn't get EPDs in this system. Yes, sir. Okay, so I'm going to paraphrase your question. Send in a good sample early on in an animal's life, 18 months of age, and then as you, that animal's age, you send in more data, and it degraded a little bit. It got bigger, right? Okay, so is that going to influence the EPD? It won't unless it's beyond the variability already accounted for in that age adjustment. So if it's different, so if you look at how alpacas age on average, if it gets worse quicker, that would influence the EPD. Yes. So the question is, samples done other than Yoakum McCall, is there any opportunity to put that in? That's beyond, that's a board of directors association question. Yeah. The answer is no. Okay. Yes, sir. Yes. The animal sustains longer, which is a lot different than the population. Yes, it would start going down. Yeah. Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so I pretty much selected my breeding pair, at least in my head. Okay, and so I'm looking at the EPDs, and let's say one of the characteristics that I'm looking at, they have a minus 0.5. The other one has a minus 2.5. And is there any indication as to what the prodigy is going to come out with, within that percentage of error? Is it going to take on the minus 2.5 within the percentage, or the 0.5 within the percentage, or someplace in between?
So is that a question, you're comparing two potential males or two potential females, or that's a male and a female? Okay, a breeding pair. So that's an excellent question, because in the analysis, we would start that animal without any other information as the average of the parents. So minus 2.5 plus a minus 0.5 is a 3. We'd start that animal at a minus 1.5. Now, Mendelian sampling and randomness of genes, it could be better than that. It could be worse. Right, right. But normally, and that's something you can do, we call that a pedigree estimate, EPD, is if you really want to know what's going to happen in the next generation, just average the parent's EPD. Yeah, yeah. Yes, sir. Sorry. Too many years of driving a tractor without a cab. Is any of the data, raw data, available to the membership? I think the answer is no, unless you share that. Can somebody help me with that question? I don't know. Have to make their animals available. It's not freely available. Of the total population. You mean as far as on an individual or the average of the population? Summary statistics is available. Individual is not. Yeah. To my knowledge, you can't. Can't. No, no. They have the person has to make it, yeah, have to make it available. Okay.
In your example of deriving what the breed value is, what would you do with the accuracy factors in determining that the expected progeny?
Okay, when we do the average of the sire and the dam to get a pedigree estimate, where would that average, where would the accuracy of that be? A little bit of that is a function of the parent's accuracy, because the more accurate they are, the more data that's gone into them, we have a better idea. But, so my answer is it depends. You could, a quick and dirty would be average the parents. I would probably put it at the lowest parent, that accuracy. Hedge your bets, because the average of the parents, they have a lot of performance data, and when you predict ahead, you have no performance data. So I'd put it towards the lower one. I've never been asked that question. That's a good question. Good. Yeah, I'll think about that more. Yeah. Any more? Okay, I've got a couple more. I'll stay down here. Can we go to PowerPoint? Thank you. Okay, the other thing is you submit data, and I don't see a lot of this, but it needs to be submitted on animals that are 270 days of age or older. And when we set the system up in discussions with Sean and a number of other folks, that seemed to be a lower threshold. So what is that, 9 months of age or older? Don't submit a flea sample on something that's 6 months of age, because it won't get used in the EPD. Okay? Because we're trying to wade out some of that maternal effect and what's happened in utero. Okay? So that's one of them. Whoops. Yeah. Okay. Couple other little things. We did a lot of research in this last run looking at time between shearing. And should we adjust for that time? Realizing the first time you send a fiber sample in, there is no time between shearing unless we go back to conception date. So it means we're starting to split our data and maybe not maximize the use of that first shear observation. And so the key is what we figured out in the current data structure, going back in history and looking at your historical data, doesn't make that much of a difference. And I suspect it's because most of you shear at a similar time. Time? Thank you. Similar time. Each year. So let's say May, and you don't have to, the key is you shear all animals this year within a day or two or a week, that same group of animals should be sheared at the same time next year. And so real quick, because I got the cut it off, on left, shearing in year one, we sheared all of those animals. That represents a contemporary group. So in year two, we sheared part of those animals then and part of the animals here. Now, the difference in time right, could be problematic if that's a huge difference. So, you know, a week's not going to make a difference in fiber characteristics. 2 months difference in splitting that group would make a difference. Okay, so as you collect data, okay, so that's a shorter time to hear, so they'd have different time to grow fleece. That could be problematic if that time is significantly different, because we're comparing these as a group versus then going on to the next year. Okay, so my goal is, just like it would be in feeding, telling you how to feed animals, try to shear animals at the same general time in the same group of animals from year to year as possible. Just like I, you know, contemporary group, feed the animals the same that are within a contemporary group, because we want them to have the same ability to express their genetic differences. Okay, so this is just a summary of some of the stuff we've covered. I think we're out of time, but I'm happy to answer any questions. I've actually lost, what time is it? How far over are we? 10:38. Holy cow. Okay. Good. You guys, this is great. I love all the questions. So if you've got to go, please go. I'll hang around here for a while and answer any questions. Either way, we'll take some public ones, but if people need to go.
Okay, question regarding heritabilities, and you see as EPDs are reported that your relationship between curve, if you're in the top 1%, usually if you look at the animal, they're in the bottom one when it comes to fleece length. Any comments on the relationship or anything to do with that?
I don't remember the genetic relationship off the top of my head, but I would tend to believe it's negative. And so it's an unfavorable relationship between curve and so selecting on curve may have adverse effects on the other trait. And so that's one of those things that you really need to find the outliers, an animal that does boast or well in both. But my guess, if that's the trend, and again, I apologize, I don't have it off the top of my head, there's a negative genetic relationship amongst those between length and curve.
I'm looking at it from a genetic standpoint. Is it a measurement issue? I don't have any reason previously to believe it's a measurement issue, but it may be driven by a unfavorable genetic relationship.
The contemporary group is your farm in the current method. Right now, there's no way for me to account for you within a herd managing those differently, because I don't get information I can create that. Maybe that's something we should do in the future, saying these animals should be grouped, these animals should be grouped, and these, because I fed them differently. That's a good comment. Yeah.
Yes.
Question on color. Do I take into account differences in color? No, we do not. I'm colorblind. Now, I could go in for an individual and look up what its color was recorded as, but right now, color is not... I'm colorblind. Yeah. Right.
When we started out doing the program, we did look at the initial results and saw that color, there were animals of color that had very good EPDs. There's more white ones because they were more highly selected before they even came here. But we decided we just couldn't see any specific effect of color, and chose not to separate and have a white EPD set and a black EPD set and a brown EPD set.
The main reason is because
just as you stated, it could have been a function of historical selection within white animals, the reason they're different, and really it's not. If you could suddenly create a new white animal, it may not have those characteristics, but it could be just a function of the history, the way they were selected. Right. Okay, one more, and we're gonna cut her off. Right.
As opposed to going out and saying, okay, I'm going to prove the traits of her high school for the traits in males.
That you want to improve? So
improve.
I'm not trying to run that by again. So you can go look for
males. The question is, looking at the searches,
yeah.
Is there a difference between looking for the males with the traits of hunting groups versus putting a team on the same, what males are likely to be isolated to the population?
I think in the long term, you'll end up at the same spot doing both. I think in the long term. For me, figuring out in that female what I want to improve, I want to go out and get the genetics so the next generation fixes the weaknesses in that female. So I got to find a specific sire or type of sire that because obviously you're not going to buy a male for each female to do. No, she doesn't influence that search. Unless you're trying to predict the next generation, you got to account for her genetics and find the sire that fits with her the best to give you what you want. Yeah. Yeah. Yes.
Need to wrap?
I'm going to stay here. Thank you all. It's been a great seminar. Thank you.